Welcome everyone to this webinar of Media Studies program at the University of Amsterdam. My name is Blandine Jauret and I'm a lecturer in Media and Culture, and I'm going to give you an overview of the Media and Culture program today.
My name is Alex Gecker. I'm a lecturer at the Media and Information and the coordinator of the Media and Information Bachelor. And I will help Blandine to explain some of the stuff about media and give a bit of more of a focus for media and information side of things.
My name is Sofia and I'm a second year student of Media and Culture, and I will give some insight as an international student into the media program.
And I'm Alicia and I will also help Sofia. I'm a second year media and information student, and yeah.
All right, so this is the program of today's webinar. We're going to start by giving a broad overview of what media studies as a discipline is concerned with. So media studies is one department, but we have two different educational programs. So we will hopefully give you all a good overview of the differences between both programs as well. After that, we're going to talk about the difference between studying at university and studying at University of Applied Sciences. And we will also go a little bit deeper into the difference between media studies and communication science. Yeah. After that, we will give you some career perspectives or some examples of what our alumni have been doing after our program. And then Alicia and Sofia will give a good insight into the student perspective of studying at our university in Amsterdam. There will be some time for questions and answers at the very end of our presentation.
So, media, in the media studies part. There are a couple of assumptions that are shared between the media and culture and the media and information programs that are generally accepted within media studies as a field. First of all, media are omnipresent. That means that we don't live just with media. It's not another thing that surrounds us, but this is a constitutive environment. This is an environment in which we live and which feeds us and shapes the way that we're feeling and seeing and understanding the world. I always remember the quote by James Carey, paraphrasing Marshall McLuhan, one of the founding granddaddies of media studies, that said, just like fish don't perceive water, human beings don't perceive media. And this is what our study is about. The things that are surrounding and shaping and helping us with through our lives, but we don't necessarily perceive them as such.
That's the department, the overarching connection between both programs. Within media and culture, we look at the link between media and culture. So our basic assumption in media and culture is that the representations that we get through media, they are not neutral representations of an objective reality. Instead, we assume that our media are formed according to cultural and social norms and values that exist within certain societies. And on the reverse side, these media and these representations also shape societies and keep these cultural values and social norms into a coherent culture. So yes, we look at the relation between social and cultural norms and media representations, as well as practices. These are four very broad research questions that media and culture students are dealing with in our program. The first question, how do media shape the way we look at ourselves and the world, is a question that concerns identity. How does my personal media use influence my self-perception, for example, but also on a broader cultural societal level, how do media, by circulating certain representations, shape cultures? The second question, which kind of stories do they tell? How do they produce meaning and guide our emotions? Is a typical question concerned with the structure of media itself. So this is, for example, topics might include the difference between certain film genres, for example. What is a typical narrative structure of a horror film? Or what's the difference between a horror film and a comedy film, for example? We also look at a broader institutional and industry context and how these affect the production of media. And we also, of course, look at the evolution of technology and its influence on the role and the function of media in society. The last question, has the function or look of certain media changed over time, is an example of a strong historical angle that we in media and culture try to cultivate. Yes.
And of course, media and information, just as media and culture, shares those two larger ideas of omnipresent media that shape our perception and experience, but adds the information angle, as you might have guessed from the title. And this is specifically referring to the way digital technologies define and shape media practices and content. So here's looking more and more at what we might call the mediatization of the world through the digital, through the abundance of computers and smartphones and the various social networks and other websites and platforms that proliferate and shape and interact with us in our daily lives. And when we talk about the couple of questions that we deal here in media and information, or that, that our students are exploring, is again this notion of platforms, those big all-encompassing technological things that are more than a website, that are more than just an app, but are different things combined, such as Facebook for social media, or Uber for transportation, or Tinder for love. How do they mediate or transform and shape various practices and aspects of life? Or another type of question, what new forms does dis- and misinformation take on those networks? So how do you understand and explore and make sense of what is colloquially referred now more and more as fake news and has been gaining prominence on the agendas of multiple political campaigns? Or from a more personal or identity-based exploration, how do new communities form, express, and engage in politics, in various types of politics through digital means, from Black Lives Matters or Me Too movement to all the way to the proliferation of various memes in election campaigns to vernacular, very closed communities on websites like Reddit and 4chan. All those communities are being shaped by the technologies in which they are inhabit, but also they shape those technologies back. And when we look at the type of objects that we look at, you can see that we deal with different types of objects, but it doesn't necessarily mean that we, in media and information and media culture, deal exclusively with those type of culture, of those type of objects. In fact, a lot of our a lot of our approaches can be complementary or shared over a specific type of objects. And one example that we can give you is something like Netflix.
Something more that I want to add about the types of media that we analyze, because as Alex just emphasized, there are, of course, overlaps. We look at the same kind of research objects, at media in all its forms and shapes. But when we study within the media and culture program, then usually the types of research questions that students ask are more on the side of film, television, radio, and cross-media. So a film student might ask to distinguish a specific style of a filmmaker. What makes a Tarantino film a Tarantino film, for example? Or we might look at the history of cinema and the influence of sound technology or color, for example, on the evolution of style in cinema. When we think of television and radio, arguably these are older types of media, so very often there we adopt a cross-media kind of angle. So how does the development of new kind of platforms influence traditional television or traditional radio broadcasting? Alex, you want to say something about the new media objects?
Yeah. So some of it, of course, as beyond the shared objects, we also have some that are a bit more specific to us. So looking at things like specific apps, and as I said before, platforms that incorporate apps such as Facebook or Twitter, and how those also from a historical perspective are being shaped by users, but also shape different types of users. Discourse, for example, you can think about the way that Twitter incorporated the RT, the retweet, which was a user-made textual thing that just like early users did for themselves, and then Twitter made it a major part of what it means to be on Twitter, or the hashtag, which started pretty much the same way. We're also looking at the type of new emerging technologies often in the sense of what medium specificity they have. So what is specific about, for example, something like VR or AR that changes the way that the media on those type of devices is produced and the way that they're being used. But yeah, as I said before, we can also look at exactly the same type of objects with media and cultures, but ask a bit of a different question. From a media and information perspective, looking at something like Netflix, you would look at the type, for example, the type that user data serves in the making of Netflix, the type of the kind of practices that they have in collecting, surveying to some extent the users that use Netflix, the fact that your Netflix profile collects information about what type of things you watch and how much you watch them and what you like, and then they might take all those all these type of information together and devise new type of shows that appeal to wider audience. This is something that was not technologically possible before the era of small segmentization, of personal segmentization of Netflix. Or we might also look at the data infrastructure of Netflix, looking at how transition protocols, data centers, CDN, content delivery networks, all those things that nobody thinks about when they think about internet video over the internet, but nonetheless make video over the internet possible. We can look at those things and ask questions about them and how they shape, for example, the growth of various streaming platforms and the streaming wars.
Right. And so a media and culture student might very well as well write about Netflix, but focus on a different kind of angle. So ask questions about the construction of meaning, for example. Why? Is a certain television series grouped together under a specific label together with other similar types of television series? Which aspects of the film language or television language, so to speak, connects different
genres?
Television series? Mm-hmm. Another type of question is the influence of the platform itself. So how does the platform of Netflix change the social experience of watching television? So I can stream television on moments that I can choose myself. I don't have to be in front of the television in the living room with my family at 9 to watch a particular primetime show. So all of these differences affect the viewing experience of TV. Another question that a student in media and culture might ask him or herself would be how the platform affects the moments where advertising breaks are included, for example. Mm-hmm. So with traditional television, advertising affects the narrative structure of our TV series. Now with Netflix, of course, this has changed considerably. So those are all questions relating to the structure and the content and the meaning of Netflix shows. So hopefully by now the difference between the two programs is a little bit more clear. Alex and I will later on proceed with giving some examples of specialization courses from both programs. But I'm very happy to give the word to Alicia and Sophia, who will give you an overview of the first year of media studies.
So the first year for us was mostly shared. So as we said earlier, Sophia is studying media and culture, and I'm studying media and information. But we started off pretty much in the same track. We had the same subjects. But this year, we're introducing a track-bound analysis course, which we will explain a bit later on.
In the media and culture, as it was said previously, it focuses more on film and TV, as well as with media and information, it will also focus on new media. These are the media objects that are in the analysis part of the section. And then for that specifically, there are thematic seminars, meaning that for some courses, you can pick a specific topic that you're more interested in studying. And then this is how typical week would look like in the first year. So you have lectures where usually media and culture and media and information students are together. And then we have, for some courses, we have screenings, which are held in a cinema outside of the university. But there are thematic screenings that are relevant to the courses. We also have seminars when you're divided into smaller groups and you do a particular topic or just break down the course with the teacher.
And just to note, this is a full-time study, so it's implied that you will spend most of your time either going to classes or working by yourself from home, which we will also expand on later.
So the first year program, as well as second and third year, we have two semesters, and each semester consists of three blocks. And in those three blocks, you have various courses that you're taking. In the first year, we have the thematic courses, the track-bound analysis for media and culture. It's media aesthetics that focuses on the analysis of film elements. And then for media and information, it is analyzing digital culture, which focuses on the analysis of information objects.
Yeah. Pretty much it.
Yeah. And then in the second semester, we're moving on to also thematic classes of media theory, which, not thematic, but more general, focuses on the theory of media, basically. And then we have media research and current themes in media studies. So these two classes allow you to choose from a specific topic you're interested in and write a research paper, an assignment on it. So for example, what I did for media research last year was I wrote a research paper about memes on a specific Facebook group, which is pretty interesting in my opinion. And we also have, in the last blocks of each semester, doing media studies, which is a more practical course for which you might have to do a project such as a video or like a film analysis and other things.
All right, thank you, Alicia and Sophia. You are really our hands-on experienced people on this panel for the first year. So I'm going to switch to the second and third year specific for media and culture. So the first year is mostly shared, apart from the analysis courses, but the second and third year, that's where you choose media and information or media and culture. So when it comes to media and culture, there are two directions, two tracks within media and culture that you can pick from. One is film, and the second is television and cross media. So there are several specialization courses that link to both topics, and I'm going to give you a very brief overview of some examples of courses that we've had over the past years. We have a standard practical component in the second year for film and television, and I already saw many questions coming on the screen here, popping up about the practical component and it's very important to emphasize that we use the practice in filmmaking or television making only to understand the theory better. So that's a very important point to analyze. So that to emphasize. The practical component falls in the second year. We have standard philosophy of the humanities, and then usually in the third year, that's where you have space to choose your elective courses, to do an internship, or to go on an international exchange. And the third year is also the moment for your very important bachelor research in the form of the BA thesis. So an example of some specialization courses that we have offered, and these shift over the years depending on the faculty members teaching these courses. We have had a course on memory and media, and this is a course that falls under the cross-media, television and cross-media track mostly. You can think of research questions involving the difference between private handwritten diaries and the popularity of vlogs these days, for example. You could also think of the influence of certain media platforms on the construction of my personal identity, but also more on a collective level. So you could be analyzing a documentary series, say, on the Second World War, or analyze a film dealing specifically with collective memory. A second example, this one falls more under the film track. This is a course, was a course on reality and special effects. So in this course, we asked mostly questions concerned with the influence of digital technology on our experience of images being more real or authentic or fake. So you probably at home all see a very nice canal, a very scenic image of Amsterdam behind us, but we see a green screen.
And that's a
typical example of how ingrained CGI digital technology manipulates our perception of reality. So how is this implemented in cinema, and why, for example, do we still consider a grainy, shaky documentary image as more more authentic than, let's say, this very smooth bullet-dodging scene from The Matrix? So these were questions dealt with in that seminar. Celebrity studies and fan studies is also a topic that links to the TV and cross-media track. You might recognize here Beyoncé announcing her pregnancy on Instagram. So what can we say about the evolution of stardom, for example? That's a question that celebrity studies deals with very specifically. Is there a big difference between a typical classical Hollywood star and a star like Beyoncé, for example? And how is a contemporary star using certain media platforms to give us a more private, personal, intimate image of herself. Film and other arts is, of course, a typical film course that we've offered. Here you can see this strong historical angle that we try to implement in our film program specifically. In this seminar, we dealt with cinema being the seventh art form. So the link between cinema and many, many different visual arts, but also literary adaptations. Can we draw comparisons between books and the adaptations of books? What can cinema do that a theater play doesn't, and vice versa? So these were some examples of media and culture specializations. And now Alex will focus on media and information.
So before I go a bit into the more in depth, I just want to clarify, we have a lot of questions on the chat. I just want to clarify the terminology a bit. We're talking about two programs, right? Media and culture and media and information are two programs. So now I'm presenting the second and third year of the media and information program. Each program consists of several tracks, which are kind of specialization, and each track consists of several courses. So what we give you here, example, are second and third year courses of our respective program, and with a tasting of both tracks. So if the tracks in media and culture are film and television and cross media, television and cross media together, the tracks, right, because it's, yeah, the tracks in media and information, my specialization is, are the following. One is new media and digital culture, and the other called information cultures. And those are a bit less obvious, potentially, than film and television, so I will briefly explain. New media and digital cultures deal more with the theoretical, conceptual understanding of new media as a cultural practices with communities, but also a bit more with the with the behavior of people on platforms and the way that platforms shape behaviors, what I mentioned before. Information cultures goes a bit more into the informational component of information as a commodity, information as a resource. It deals a bit more with more traditional or changes to more traditional institutions like archives and libraries under information, etc., etc. Both programs in the second and third year have some example of a practical component. Both also share this core course of philosophy of the humanities and help you understand the broader issues that are at stake with our field and society in the broader. Both offer opportunities, as the chat asked, to do electives, also in the form of thematic minors, to carry on internships in the Netherlands and abroad, and to go on exchange courses abroad, earning credits that will make part of your degree and allows you to customize your degree a bit. And both, also just like media and culture, in the third year will have you write a large personal and self-made big thesis paper, which is a kind of a culmination of all your work and practices here. Now I want to give you a couple of examples of the courses that you might be doing in the media and information second and third year. Digital methods and information analytics is a course that's shared between the two tracks, between new media and digital culture and information culture. So everybody who do media and information do this course. And it gives you basic tools to understand digital media from within, so to speak, by using the digitally native tools and using slightly computational methods. So it's not computer science, it's not programming, but it does. We do teach you some basic tools. So, for example, understand what does a like network look like, or as you can see here, a graph of suggestions that YouTube has for certain YouTube videos, and kind of to try to think about a certain platform from within, from what constitutes it. Likes for Facebook, recommendations for YouTube. Another example before I throw the glass off. Coding the Humanities is the is an information cultures track which teaches basic approaches to computer programming and some basic programming skills to help you access various types of information online better, under the assumption that today more and more of the different types of media that we have access to are actually black box from us. We don't see what's inside them because most people, for example, don't have the coding or digital literacy capacities to understand them. So we get only what's on the outside. Whereas this course will give you some practical tools about opening up this black box and looking into the, what makes digital media digital, and on the way teaching you a couple of valuable skills, for example, being able to script and code basic things. Digital objects and research practices is an interesting course in the new media and digital culture track that opens up. It's kind of a bit of a taster course. We're quite proud of how it ended up being because it's different sessions with different teachers each time, 2 weeks module, several 2 weeks modules, each one focusing on a specific topic, on a specific practice, on a specific way of doing things, moving from information visualization, privacy and security online, and all the way up to podcasts and creating your own podcast is essentially the final assignment for this course. Finally, another example, histories of digital culture. We are very much looking into the future, but we never forget the past. And in fact, historicity and kind of the histories of all those devices and platforms and publics is a big part of our program. Histories of digital culture is a look back at what made, what kind of decisions and processes and larger societal shifts have created the media landscape as it is today. For example, something like Mondo 2000 or Wired, which is a bit more of the famous one, were two magazines that ended up shaping print magazines, you know, from the good old-fashioned dead trees kind, that ended up shaping a lot of how we understand Silicon Valley and ICT culture today before it even existed. Yeah. And now I'll give the stage to Alicia, who will explain a bit about the difference between media studies and communication science.
So I decided to talk about this because before I applied to university, I was choosing between media studies or communication science. So if you look into them a bit in depth, you'll notice that the media studies course is a bit on the humanities side. It's within the Faculty of Humanities, while the communication science program is within science and it's a social science. So one focuses, the media studies one focuses on qualitative research, so we do a bit more of analysis and interpretation of texts. Meanwhile, the communication science course focuses on quantitative research, which involves a lot of numbers, statistics, and
data.
To me, yeah, data, and to me, this was not as interesting. So in the end, what I did is I went to study media and information because I thought I would probably enjoy humanities more and the research is a bit more interesting in my opinion. But I still thought communication science was also very interesting and probably quite useful in practical terms. So I decided to take a minor in my second year. And the minor of communication science allowed me to kind of focus on the interesting subjects and topics in communication without having to do the statistics part. So it's quite useful in my opinion.
And several people have asked us, are asking in the chat about, for example, marketing careers. And I would say that for some of you, communication science might be a bit more relevant than media studies, and you should check it out as well, because in marketing specifically, there is a big emphasis on effects, on statistical proof of what works and what doesn't work, on working with numbers. That's what a lot of marketing is. And to some extent, although there are some components of it, for example, in the informatics cultures track, communication science as a different program might be more suitable to you.
Yes, but there's also one quote from communication science that they like to use a lot, which is some media has some effects on some people. So I would say that communication science focuses more on studying the effects of media, while media studies is looking into how the media works, like what it does to cause these effects.
Yes, very well put.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And with this, I think it's good to emphasize one other thing that also been cropping up in the chat quite a lot, and we get this asked quite often, namely the practical component of the program and the career trajectories, which Blandine will address in a bit. So one thing that is worth emphasizing is in the Netherlands, there are kind of two parallel systems. There are universities and the universities of applied sciences or HBOs, not the channel with the films, but this is the abbreviation in Dutch of Universities of Applied Sciences. With the first, which is us, focusing a bit more on the notion of developing research skills, of working independently and developing an independent study practices, such as working in small groups, working on your own project. There is generally less contact hours in our university compared to University of Applied Sciences. You might have seen this table that we've shown you before of how a typical week might look like and thought, oh, that's fun, little breezy schedule. But no, the idea is you do a lot of self-reading, a lot of self-study, and your success in the program depends on that. And generally speaking, universities prepare you for a field with a more broader jack-of-all-trades type of education. Now, whereas universities of applied sciences, they do teach you more professional skills. For example, for those of you who might be interested in film, there might be universities of applied sciences that work more as film schools with specific courses on how to film and edit and operate equipment. There are much more group projects that are centered around the production of a like media thing, for example, a short film or, for example, an app. There are more contact hours, there's less self-study, and it usually focuses on a profession. So if you're particularly certain that there is a profession that you want to study, you know, social media marketing, advertising, you can probably also check some of those universities of applied sciences and the specific professional degrees that they offer, just to, you know, save you some time from looking into it later. But that doesn't mean that our graduates don't end up in those professions as well. It just means that they go there, they find their way through a more broader field. They often come with a bit more understanding of the complexity and the interplay of the things. They come with a much more stronger writing and research perspectives and often end up in roles that require those type of things. But we thought that this is a important thing to emphasize.
Right. And what Alex has just said and emphasized is that we prepare our students for working in a broader field. So now we come to this big important question of the types of professions that you can do with a degree, either in media and culture or in media and information. And as you can see, this diagram, not as you can see, but this diagram is based on a very small scale study of our alumni on LinkedIn. So you can see that the huge part, the red part, is the audiovisual and digital media field. And that's very wide. And it links to the basic fact, how we started this presentation as well, that we live in media and that media permeate all aspects of our lives. And also, therefore, that if you have gained the analytical skills that we offer our students in the program, that you can apply these skills in very many different types of professions. So an example from the media and culture part, in the audiovisual digital media, we have student or alumni, I should say, not students anymore, but alumni working on programming for film festivals or film museums, for example. We also have a lot of students that end up in written journalism, writing film criticism or media and television criticism in newspapers or online. Do you want to give some specific examples of media and information?
Yeah, sure.
Alumni?
We have people working in the technology field, which is almost more broad than saying in the film industry, right? We have people working for startups. There's a vibrant and healthy startup culture here in Amsterdam. But also people working in kind of research and marketing and various digital ... positions in big organizations such as government institutions, corporate offices, basically any title with the prefix digital that you can think about, we have our alumni working in it. So.
Well, from both programs, many also end up in education, or some, and that's only if you have a knack for research, for example, some end up being academics or researchers. And there are even alumni that ended up in policy making and think tanks.
Yeah.
So you can see that the possibilities are very wide, and therefore, it's very important to choose your courses, your electives, wisely, and to think very actively about which type of internship you might want to do.
So, or a minor.
Or a minor, exactly.
Yep.
So these questions are important during your studies. I think that's what I wanted to say about the what's next slide. So I'm going to again give the word to Alicia and Sophia, and they can talk about whatever they would still like to emphasize from the student perspective.
So first of all, I wanted to talk about how the transition into university, specifically University of Amsterdam, which may seem to most not what you see in films and TV programs as an American typical university. University of Amsterdam has many campuses around the city. The media courses are centered in right in the center of Amsterdam, very nice and pretty and historic. And the differences between high school and uni is that we have a way more, I would say, free-looking schedule, that you have very few classes, but on the other hand, you do have to dedicate a lot of hours to writing and reading and preparing for those classes, because once you come to a class, to a lecture or a seminar, you need to be ready to ask questions or participate in discussions. Because we don't have, it's not like school where you come and things are just given to you and explained easy and simple. And then also at the university, we don't have something like a sports team or teams like university spirit situation, but that doesn't take away
from...
We
have small spirit, not the university
It's mainly within the faculties. We still have student associations at the university that people can join, and we have a media studies association as well that you can join. But the student life in Amsterdam is still very vibrant, as we have... Amsterdam is a very cultural city. There's a lot to do. There's exhibitions, events, festivals, anything you can do. Meet many different people. I met a lot of friends and networking groups through volunteering at different festivals, from whether it be a music festival or a film festival. So that's... The fact that the university is spread out doesn't mean that you're not going to get a student life in the city. And then also from my side, and like based on the questions asked, I would like to specify that media and culture, specifically film track, is not a film school. You don't study to be a film director or a screenwriter or any of that. We do have a practical aspect that shows you, slightly opens the door into the film production world, but it still doesn't, I would say, it doesn't make it a film school. It's still more on the theory side, where we mostly learn through reading and writing and researching into the world of media.
Would you say that it's also, I saw a question before about like under getting a foot in the door, and that's what also you mean. Does it give you some idea about like how the film industry functions? And
We had a course where we had previous alumni who are now working in production companies and in film industry and TV industry come and give us talks. So they finished media and culture program specifically and then went on into the film world. But you just have to understand that the university and this degree does not prepare you. It's not a profession that you would go and be a director straight afterwards, but it still gives you an overview of how the world works. And for me, it gave me an idea of what I would want to do after my graduation in that world. So,
Just to also clarify what Sophia said earlier, a lot of our homework consists of reading quite a lot of texts, I would say. And in order to understand them, you would probably want to take notes or highlight things while you do so. And you need to be prepared, like really prepared. Because at the end of the day, once your exam or final assignment comes around, you will really need this knowledge. It's not really like at school when you're given, oh, you need to, you know, fill in this worksheet or, you know, do this, write an essay. It's not really like that. You do a lot of self-study, a lot of research, try to understand the text, and you come to the lectures and seminars being prepared. So,
The grading situation, how the courses are structured, is that For some courses, you might have weekly assignments. They can be short written assignments of about 250, 500 words. But then also for some courses, you will only have one final exam where the reading and writing and preparing really helps out, because in the 8-week span, you can't just learn all the knowledge one day ahead of the exam. We also have research papers at the end of courses that you need to write. Again, throughout the course, you will be making steps to completing that research paper, because it involves a lot of work on your own and finding and analyzing material that is previously, I think for me, was unknown world of like academic research. So that's the situation with that.
And just to kind of finish up, I would say that the media course is great if you don't really know what specifically you want to do, but you're kind of interested in media, marketing, digital, whatever. As I've seen from the questions, a lot of people are asking, will this prepare me for this kind of career or not? I would say that taking this course, at least for me, and I know for a lot of fellow students as well, it kind of helps you find your passion and maybe narrow down what you're interested in, and then you can go ahead and maybe take a minor, or after your studies, maybe take a master's in what you're more interested in. So I would say that this broad field of study is really great if you want to explore the things you like and develop your passion sometime at the end of it, hopefully.
Yeah, I would say also in the third year, you're given an option of doing an internship, which also helps you to figure out which kind of field you would want to work at, because you can do an internship at this type of, let's say, social media company. And if that's not something to your taste, then you still have your thesis that you're writing, and that degree gives you still an option of going somewhere else if that's not exactly what you think suits you most. Also, I saw a question about, I lost it.
Never mind. Well, maybe if you remember it later.
The workload. Oh, yes. The workload, the jump from high school to university, I wouldn't say, for me personally, it wasn't a big step, because previously in high school, I was already doing my work on time and sticking to the deadlines. But if you're more in the relaxed high school way of when you're always reminded of when the assignment is due and when you need things to be done, that's not what happens in the university. You need to put that yourself in your schedule. When is your exam? When is your deadline? And then stick to that, because no one's going to chase after you. And that's, I think, also the big part of University of Amsterdam and Dutch universities, is when the university takes a lot of students for the program, but then throughout the first year and following years, you need to prove worthy and willing of studying in that program and that you really belong here.
And to that point, I also want to add, because I saw several questions also about the size of our program. And it's true that we don't have a fixed or numerus fixus in the program yet. So that means that we are a large program. And this has a lot of positive sides. We have a lot of different cultures. Our students come from all corners of the world. But it can make the transition from high school to university a little bit more challenging, perhaps. I have to emphasize there also that throughout the 3 bachelor years, you will have a tutor who will guide you through your study program as well, so you are not left completely on your own. And the fact that we have lectures combined with seminars, our lectures, the size of our first year is quite considerable. You can think of a lecture hall with 500 to 600 first-year students, but these are always combined with smaller group seminars of a maximum to 25 students in a seminar group. So that also should offer a platform for more close connections with your peers.
I really want to, I think, for the third or fourth time, to emphasize this idea that people are asking in the chat about how much people are getting in and what's the size and what's like the accept ratio. And this is really not how the Dutch higher education system works in most cases. And I find it, somebody coming from outside in the Netherlands, I find it actually quite better. The idea, as was pointed out, is if you have the basic requirements and the willingness to come and do this program, most chances are you will be accepted. But you will be evaluated continuously, mostly throughout the first year, but then continuously on your ability to deliver. And your actual test of whether you're fitting within the program would be you fitting within the program and succeeding in the courses and putting up the work to get the grades and pass the courses that make up the program. Second thing that I wanted to emphasize is a lot of people ask about the possibility of switching between the two programs, media and culture and media and information. This, to some extent, ties to the first point. The first years are designed to be quite close, except for one thematic course, partially because it gives you, and it gives you also a bit of a taster opportunities to doing courses from the other programs, because we can ostensibly see the possibility for people to switch to another program at the end of the first year. But then from the year second, from the second and third year onwards, you kind of really commit to one or the other program, and it becomes significantly more harder to switch.
One addition, a small addition, with a risk of complicating things, but within the specific programs, it's entirely possible to take some film courses, for example, and combine with television courses. And in your elective space, you can also juggle a little bit. But switching is exactly possible after the first year. And based on the comments, I'm trying to read as fast as the chat goes here.
It's a bit
here,
like Twitch.
But it's an important point that I saw passing by, and it concerns language, because we are here with Alicia and Sophia, both international students. The media and culture program is also offered in Dutch for Dutch-speaking students. So that's also an important aspect to emphasize. You can study media and culture in English, but also in Dutch. And Dutch students are not going to be forced to be writing in English if they do not want that. I'm also trying to... No, never mind. All right, so two programs.
We have questions about... do we want to move to the question slide?
Yes.
Just so we have yeah, there were a bunch of questions. Sorry, you wanted to say?
Yeah, I wanted to say about the international part. Mm-hmm. Also, that was the question, because both me and Alicia are international students.
Non-European international students.
Yeah, non-EU. It's Amsterdam and Netherlands is very international. A lot of people speak English, and they're all willing to help you out in case of settling in and everything else. As well as within the program, there is no separation, I would say, by nationality or any sort of groupings, because we both have friends of all sorts of nationalities throughout the place, as well as Dutch people, as well as people from all over the world.
Yep.
So that's not, I wouldn't say, there is no need to worry that you're going to be somewhat excluded when you come to the Netherlands.
Mm-hmm. I also wanted to talk a little bit about the job questions. So I saw a lot of people asking if they would be able to do a part-time job or not. To be honest, this is a full-time study. You might have the time to do it if you can manage it, but I wouldn't recommend it, because I feel that you spend quite a lot of time doing self-study. So even if the schedule is really flexible, like at some point I only had maybe 3 classes a week, it doesn't really mean that you have time for a job on top of that. Well, it all depends on how you can manage your time. But to be honest, not recommended. Maybe not in the first year.
For sure.
Maybe in the third year. I mean, we have quite a lot of free time for internships and other stuff. So you could consider that.
Yes. And this is also something that Alicia, you mentioned before, is... Sophia, I'm sorry. You mentioned before that you... that you had worked as an intern volunteer on festivals. Yeah. So,
but that's, again, that's like a week, 2 weeks within your year. That's still experience that you can do, but then it's not a full-time or part-time throughout the year. job, yes. Which still allows you to do certain things. But again, I wouldn't recommend doing a full-time or part-time job, like right. with a set schedule, right. with yeah. your studies as well. Also, because there were a lot of questions about points, credits, as mm-hmm. we say. So I think it's nice to touch on yes. how the program, the Dutch system works, is that throughout the 3 years, you need 180 credits mm-hmm. to get your degree. The first, every year you get 60 credits. In the first year, you have a set of courses that you need to take and that you're not allowed to, say, pick any others instead, which will give you 60 credits. And then in the second year, we have a set amount of courses, but we also have some electives that you can pick that will also give you credits. Again, you will get 60 in total. And in your third year, you have a choice of a minor, an internship or a semester abroad. And then your thesis, again, in total, you will get 60 credits. In the electives, you can pick electives from, again, media studies of different topics, for example. So as a media and culture student, I can pick an elective from a media and information course, but also I can go into take a minor in marketing or a minor in economics or in something else like that. Also with credits, the courses that we have a course that lasts 8 weeks, that's 6 credits, and then a course that lasts 14 weeks. So
12 or 16, it depends on it.
Yeah, the one that runs over two blocks,
yeah.
right.
that will give you 12 credits. Yeah.
Year.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's how it all breaks down. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, but then in the second year, for example, you might have some courses that are second and third block. But yeah. we don't need to overcomplicate.
Interesting point, though, because someone had asked about the structure of exams and exam moments in the year. And on the slide, mm-hmm. you can see the whole first year, for example, and you can see it has 2 semesters. And if, like, after the first 8 weeks, you will have an exam finishing off the course Living Information.
Mm-hmm.
And then after the second block, again, 8 weeks long, you will have a finishing exam for Media Culture in Transformation and a finishing exam for your track-bound analysis course. So the idea
and in between you might have assignments.
Exactly,
yeah.
If the course runs for 2 blocks. So the idea behind this structure is that it should be doable, if you have studied well, to finish off courses with an exam immediately after the course has terminated. So,
but also, as we said before, not all courses have exams. Like, for example, media theory and media research and current themes in media studies, they were both research papers that we needed to hand in at the end of the course.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I saw one question about doing an internship and a minor at the same time. That's not possible, because for the internship to count enough credits for you to graduate, you do a full-time internship, so it would be a 9-to-5 job. So then a minor with the schedule of the classes cannot fit in with that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's you will have to pick either a minor or an internship. If you really want to do an internship, then you can take one during the summer.
Yes. And this is also connected. Some people ask about connected to what you, Blondine, said in some of the questions, about when's the vacations are. In the Dutch systems, there are, in higher education, there are far fewer vacations that some people might be used to in some other kind of higher education programs. As you can see, the first semester goes from September, January, with 2 weeks vacation around Christmas and New Year's. And the second semester goes from February to June with no large vacations whatsoever. There are usually in between the blocks a week of no classes, which usually means that those are the week for submitting or preparing submitting assignments, preparing for final exams, etc., etc. But yes, the program is the study year is quite intensive, and it is so might be different from some other programs, some in other places. Including from the Netherlands, by the way. One other question that I noticed is like how media studies in Amsterdam is different from other media studies program in other universities. Well, one thing might be some other universities, Utrecht and Rotterdam, have a different course structure. They have 10-week blocks rather than 8- and 4-week blocks. And this shapes their program a bit differently from the student's perspective. But I guess you're asking in terms of themes and topics and specialization. I think the answer is quite broad, and I wouldn't want to reduce it to a short, brief talking point. I would advise you to go, if you're interested in other programs, media programs, if you're interested in other media programs in the internet, to go on the websites and check the information that is there. There are some things I can talk about media information that we're specialized in. We have, for example, this entire emphasis on digital methods of understanding media from within. We have emphasis on kind of the platformization and the political economy of platformization, meaning what are the deep processes that make the Facebooks and the Ubers and the Netflixes of the world tick underneath the hood. We have all those specializations. You're very welcome to go on our website on the website of the specific program and look at those specializations and look at the course descriptions to understand what Amsterdam brings to media. And I guess the same, there are a specialization in media and culture.
Yes, media and culture in Amsterdam focuses, for example, to give a difference between the program in Utrecht and Amsterdam, is that we focus less on the link with theater, for example. So Utrecht links media and culture to theater as well. We don't do that.
And games they have more games for new media, which we have less.
Games as well. Yes, so it becomes a bit tricky sometimes. The point of this webinar is also not to draw all the attention to our program. We want you to be well informed so that you make a good choice, because if you choose wrongly, you lose money and a lot of energy. So this is the point of this webinar, and I'm reading that it's very useful.
Thanks, Alexia.
Thank you. And yes, one more little addition to the holiday point, because we are a very international program, we understand that students might want to travel home for Christmas, for example, or during a summer holiday. And these two blocks doing media studies that you see there, they are in January and June, and it's entirely possible, if you work hard and you are disciplined enough, to do those assignments. They're like portfolio building courses, and it's possible to do them in a faster track so that you can keep these months free to go home. I think this is all that I wanted to emphasize. Are there any urgent points that we are forgetting?
Well, there was a question about registration, and to specify, first year in the beginning for the first semester, you registered automatically for all the courses, because in the first year you do a set amount of courses that are necessary. You can't choose any others. For the exams, you registered obviously automatically as long as you are participating in the course and you're registered for that course. For the second semester in your first year, you will have to register for the courses yourself. However, you will previously know which courses to register for, and there are guides on the websites that you can follow how to do that, so there's nothing stressful about it. It's very simple to do. And I think that's about it.
I suggest we do a lightning round answers, short answers to questions that we've spotted. People are asking, is it hard to go from a Dutch-based media program to media field abroad? Like working in the United States after doing this program? The answer is maybe. There are a lot of big questions about this. What kind of media? Where in the United States? What kind of program do you choose? I would say look at the description of the courses and look at the type of jobs that you're interested in and decide for yourself. Somebody asks whether there is a possibility to create your own videos and stuff like that in the beginning. So, as was mentioned already, this is not a film school, but already in the first year, you have the possibility to work a bit on the video essay as part of the Dewey Media Studies course, like editing an assignment or an essay.
For the Living Information.
We had a creative
group project we also made a video for without the special equipment. However, in the media and culture track in the second year, we have a practical course where you do get equipment from the university that we get to learn how to use. And that's a fun one, again, but that's not going to be present throughout the whole year and through the whole program, because that's not the main focus of the program.
Yeah, and in media and information, there's the occasional, again, like something like already in the first year, a bit of data scraping, basic programming, basic kind of introduction to the notions behind user interfaces, if not really doing user interface design.
Yeah. The media and culture practical side, what our students also emphasized is that you will be learning to spot certain techniques and to link meaning to that. For example, why is a filmmaker using a close-up here instead of a long shot, for example, or why a slow motion? So those are analytical skills that you will learn in media and culture, but by making your own short film and making your own choice for a close-up or a slow motion, you might better understand the meaning behind these techniques. So that's the basic reason for having this practical component.
The question about housing, it's a very big question for anyone living in Amsterdam and in the Netherlands. Me and Alicia, in the first year, we were lucky and we signed up and registered for the housing program through the university, and we both got student housing. Yeah. However, for the second and third year, you will have to find housing on your own, with your friends or on your own, in the free market area, which is
Facebook groups.
Yeah, other ways. It can be complicated. So that's, I think, one downside of living in Amsterdam. But then on the other hand is, during your first year, you get acquainted with the city very well. So then I think it allowed us to know more and
be more prepared.
Yeah, for what comes.
Struggle.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you have a place to live.
Yeah. We don't live in a box. Everyone has housing. Yeah. So that's okay. In the first year, there is, I think, a very high chance of everyone, if you register on time, to get student accommodation, which allows you to socialize with all the students from your faculty and also to know the city better, because you will be visiting your friends around different student housings as well. So
yeah, and someone mentioned the student hotel. I'm staying there now. It's pretty nice. But also, please book it like on time, because it's always
full.
Yeah.
It's going to be overwhelmed now.
Yeah. Well,
I'm also reading one point about when the program starts, and our program starts the first week of September, and especially for international students, we have introductory weeks starting the second week of August, possibly already. I'm not 100% sure, but it is advised to arrive a little bit earlier.
But you'll get all your information through the admissions.
Yeah,
of course. All right, so there are still many, many questions, but since you all logged in from all corners of the world, and also from the Netherlands, actually, it's not all very distant, we cannot really answer all these questions. We will have future information rounds. One is the Bachelor Day upcoming. Mm-hmm. That's in March. There will also be taster sessions for media and culture and media and information, where you can do some tryout, and you can also follow some actual real courses and accompany a real media studies student by being student for a day. All of these information sessions require that you are physically here in Amsterdam, of course. So I think we can finish off this webinar. We want to thank you for your attention, for your interest in the program, and we hope that we have given you enough insight in both our programs, actually.
Yep.
So thank you very much. And
thank you for your attention. And maybe see you in Amsterdam.
Maybe. Who knows?
Bye.